a short, tantalizing drive from AT&T Park, where they hope to be someday. And certainly a number of Giants players have rolled through this stadium. Current active Giants, including Pablo Sandoval and Buster Posey, amongst others. Meanwhile, settling in, Freddie Avis, the designated hitter, batting from the left side, hoping to do his best Pablo Sandoval imitation by getting a base hit, but he's going to take strike one from Carswell outside. Outside corner, I should say. Carswell's delivery also on the outside corner against strike two. Carswell is operating Bo with a modified stretch. He is not doing a full windup, and he's kind of just stepped slightly off to the side of the plate, so it's a pretty easy transition if runners get on base.
Yeah, well, what it is, it simplifies things. Sometimes when you go from the full setup, you're doing too much motion. So if you want to simplify things, break things down a lot easier, simple stretch, straight shoot to the plate.
Carswell's 1-2 pitch, curveball lifted high in the air and deep, hustling Jordan O'Donnell, and he's not going to get there. It's going to hit the warning track, and on his way to third is Avis, where he is going to hold up with a leadoff triple. Boy, he got a good one to hit right there, and O'Donnell, a great effort, but couldn't make the play. That ball actually probably hung up in the air a little bit longer, given that it was hit to right and the wind is blowing right to left.
Yeah, that wind definitely pushed it away from O'Donnell. Carswell was pitching away from the batter majority of that at-bat. This time brings a breaking ball, breaks right over the heart of the plate, and because of it, gets a leadoff triple. What a way to start off for Menlo.
Mikey DeKroger now the batter, batting from the left side. And he will look at one just off the outside edge, ball one.
As you can see, Carswell working away from the batters, trying to stay away from the hitting zone of these Menlo players.
This one is low and in, 2-0.
Menlo in three games in this tournament, outscoring their opponents 26-3. So... there.
Well, this looks like a typical Menlo game, at least to start, with a runner at third and nobody out. This pitch is up, 3-0 on DeKroger. Chris Zeisler in the on-deck circle. DeKroger, 3-0, will probably be taking here. And he takes ball four. Good start for Menlo. And this brings Zeisler to the plate.
We'll see how Carswell reacts. He might have got a little shaken off that leadoff triple. This is a big stage right here. Players aren't used to playing in a stadium of this size and nature. And because of it, it could shake up certain players negatively.
And well, Menlo's been here the last few years. Pacific Grove is not. Here's a toss over to first.
And that does make a huge difference, Jeff. When your whole setup, your mind frame coming into a game like this, when you've been here before, it pays dividends.
Healthy lead for DeKroger at first base as we have an interesting first and third situation. DeKroger not going to go on that pitch, and it catches the outside corner for a strike.
Nice. Way to come back. He was down the first two batters he faced and gets ahead in his third batter.
Coach Schoaf over at third with his arms folded. I don't know if that's displeasure, somebody missed a sign, or that's his traditional stance over there, coach at third. Throw over to Kroger back into the bag.
Usually it means someone missed a sign.
That's how we're interpreting it from up here. 0-1 to Zeisler. Carswell, this one's fouled back right into just press row to our right next to the press box. 0-2 on Zeisler, and yet DeKroger staying over at first. We'll see if they're going to test Bershinger's arm, and that sets up an interesting situation because what happens for Avis down at third base? Does he try to go? We saw that in the previous game.
Right.
Aptos was able to scratch out a run on a first-third situation when the runner at first got caught in a rundown, and that allowed the runner from third to get in against St. Ignatius, but the Wildcats came back and won that game against Aptos 5-3. The 0-2 to Zeisler. Well outside. DeKroger almost got caught leaning the wrong way, and Bershinger faked a throw. One ball and two strikes.
Carswell still working the outside of that plate, trying to stay away from the powerhouse of these big Menlo hitters.
A ball and two strikes the pitch. Fouled back, this time over the top of the stadium. Count remains 1-2. Good at-bat for Zeisler here.
Yeah, fell two straight back. So usually when you see foul balls come straight back like that, the batter is usually right on it and just missing it.
The 1-2 pitch just outside. Bershinger setting up out away, seeing if he can get Zeisler to go fishing. Zeisler doesn't cast.
All six pitches, Jeff, outside of the plate. He's going to eventually need to come in because these big hitters are going to scoot closer and closer.
The 2-2. Oh, what a great breaking ball. Zeisler caught with a bat on his shoulder. One down in the inning.
First K of the game. Got him looking. And that was the same exact pitch Avis ripped in the gap in right center. But this time, he started it inside and got the inside corner. He's working that outside inside very well right there on that at bat.
Well, and Avis saw the curveball break towards him, whereas Zeisler was seeing it break away. Now the batter is Batchelder, and he's going to pop one foul down the third base side. The number four slot in the batting order has been a bit of an adventure for Menlo this year. Not in that the players haven't been producing, but that they've been getting hurt. They have run, this is their fourth different number four hitter. And as Coach Schoaf was telling us before the game, he had three number four hitters go down in 8 days due to injury. Broken leg, pulled hamstring, sprained wrist. Batchelder, the fourth one, but he said he's responded five doubles so far in the tournament to go along with that no-hitter he threw earlier on. This one is a breaking ball low and in, 1-1. So Batchelder has picked up the slack, but as we were joking with Coach Schoaf before the game, really a Bermuda Triangle situation for Menlo so far this year. We're in the bottom of the first inning, no score, runners at the corners. This pitch just off the plate. Carswell doesn't like the call. 2-1.
Nice idea. You're going to have to switch it up with this cleanup hitter. Carswell doesn't throw with a lot of velocity, so he's going to need to switch up his fastball and breaking stuff.
Infield at double play depth. This pitch low and in. Nice block by Bershinger. Runners are going to stay where they are. 3-1. Though probably, Bo, it doesn't hurt Pacific Grove all that much if they walk Batchelder here and pitch to King. The base is loaded. You still have a double play situation.
Yeah, and you don't want to give a fastball right down the plate right here to the cleanup hitter. And that's the problem you run into when you throw some breaking balls that aren't hitting the strike zone, is you fall behind and you eventually have to throw that fastball.
Carswell on the 3-1. This one's poked in the air to shallow left, and it's going to be dropped, but all the runners are going to be safe. Holding at third was Avis, who had to hold just in case the ball was caught. Heads up by DeKroger, who went at least halfway so he wouldn't get caught in a tough situation if the ball was dropped. And ending up at first is Batchelder on a bloop single to left.
Wow. There's no such thing as really a lucky hit in this game, but he just stuck his bat out there. Great discipline at the plate. Saw an outside pitch, almost got fooled by it, but kept his bat in the zone just long enough to get a piece of it off the end of the bat. Unfortunate for Pacific Grove and Wes Carswell, who now faces with the bases loaded with the number five hitter up.
The batter is Will King. Carswell's going to step off the rubber for just a moment, look around. Coach Schoaf had to quiet his dugout there on that third base side because I think they were yelling at Avis to run after the ball hit the ground. But Coach Schoaf electing to play it safe. Here's the first pitch, fouled straight back.
It took the umpire somewhat of a couple seconds, too, to call that because the left fielder, Amater, rolled over it. So he couldn't really tell if he came up with it cleanly. Therefore, the third base coach. And nonetheless, you still have one out, guy on third, a sack fly was still working this position.
This is a curveball that just misses in. 1-1. Outfield is playing shallow in center and left. Deeper in right is Jordan O'Donnell. Against the left-handed hitting King. The 1-1 pitch. Up and away, 2-1. Carswell having to throw a lot of pitches here in this first inning. Bases loaded, one out.
The discipline of these Menlo hitters is giving Carswell a bit frustration here in the first.
The pitch, Low, 3-1. Now, Carswell does not have the luxury of putting King on. There's nowhere to put him. So King in couldn't get a much juicier hitter's count than this, especially with the bases loaded. The 3-1 pitch, Carswell's going to have to come right at him. And he's going to miss. And the first run comes in courtesy of a bases loaded walk. And an easy RBI for Will King. Second walk of the inning issued by Carswell. And Austin Marcus is the batter. So everyone moves up 90 feet. DeKroger now at third. Batchelder at second. King at first. One out, 1-0 Menlo. Carswell goes from the stretch and leaves one upstairs for a ball, and Bershinger's going to talk it over with his pitcher. Almost looks like at the moment Carswell is rushing the delivery. Is that your sense, Bo, as well? He seems to be moving it just a little bit too quickly.
Yeah, he's just getting the ball up right now in the zone, and his breaking stuff is just not catching the plate. It's just a couple inches off, and it's tough, too, because when you face a team like this, you want that breaking ball to get over because they're such a great fastball-hitting team.
This pitch is going to be on the inside corner for a strike. So whatever Bershinger just told Carswell worked well on that pitch, 1-1. But that time it looked like, well, if you're leaving the ball up high, it usually means you're rushing something. And Carswell slowed down the delivery a little bit and got a strike. And there he does as well. But this one is driven deep to center field. Fading on it is Burner. He will make the catch. This will get a run in. Batchelder will stay at second base. But on the sack fly, scoring is DeKroger. And there are runners at first and second with two down on the sacrifice fly by Austin Marcus.
Great job by Marcus. Got a good piece of the bat, or a good piece of the ball. Just got a little under it, but still drove it out to left center for the second run.
Sam Crowder now the batter. Two down in the inning. And here's a fastball in the outside corner for a strike.
And a lot of it too, Jeff, was Carswell's been working behind a lot of the batters, and this time he gets ahead of this one, so.
The 0-1, curveball, and Crowder swatted at that one like he was trying to get a fly buzzing around his face. It was up and in, too, 0-2.
Well, and that's the luxury of getting ahead of your batters. You leave pitches open. The batter can't rely just on one pitch.
So Crowder in a hole. Carswell taking a long look at his catcher, Bershinger, and then comes set. Outside corner, strike three. So Menlo gets two runs. Carswell gets himself out of a situation that could have come a lot worse. He strikes out two in the inning. We have completed one full inning of baseball here in the Division III championship game. In the Central Coast section, you are following the action on CIFCentralCoast.tv, part of the Play On High School Sports Network. You're also following it online on YouTube.com/PlayOnNetwork.
You can watch highlights or replay of today's game in our on-demand section. And you could also buy a DVD or Blu-ray of today's game right on our CIFCentralCoast.tv. Click on Buy DVD and you can order today's game right now. Have a game that lasts a lifetime. Brought to you by CIFCentralCoast.tv.
Jeff Kurtz alongside Bo Fertig. Robert Fields braving the sun right below us to provide you all the video here today. It is a cooler than normal day in San Jose, though we understand last year, for those of you who weren't in attendance or were following along from points afar, that there was a thunderstorm between games 2 and game 3 that caused a delay, and they didn't get started that third game until 9:30 in the evening, finished around midnight. We expect no such weather interruptions here this afternoon.
Clear skies today. It's turned out to be a beautiful day today, Jeff.
Yeah, we had a little bit of light rain yesterday in the Bay Area, and we've got a few scattered clouds around here and some fog rolling over the hills towards the ocean, but which will cool things down for the evening affair and will cause the baseball to not travel quite as far. But don't mention that to Freddie Avis, who already drove one to the warning track for a triple to lead off the game, and he came around to score one of the two Knights runs in the first inning. Now, Conyall Cody, Dan Bershinger, and Jordan O'Donnell set to face Jake Batchelder, who is working with a 2-0 lead, and Batchelder has been money for Menlo in these playoffs. On the mound and at the plate, but now with a two-run lead, let's see if he can make that hold up here in the second inning as Cody takes outside for a ball 1-0. Outfield is shading the left-handed hitting Cody to right. This one bounced to that right side, and the second baseman is over easily, and Crowder to Baxter for the first out. Crowder actually had to wait for Baxter to get there, and Cody flying down the line almost beat that one out, but instead went away.
Nice hustle by Cody right there, getting down the first baseline. A lot of the times you'll see a player roll over and just kind of trout down the first baseline when it's hit to the right side of the field. Not Cody. Great effort.
Dan Bershinger now the batter. Bershinger, the starting catcher for Pacific Grove, looks at a pitch up for a ball, 1-0. I got to tell you, I like the signal calling for our home plate umpire, Darius Ghani, and that he lets you roll right away if it's a ball or a strike. This is ball two. Our previous umpire in the first game, Greg Jackson, had a little bit of a flare and would delay the signal, so he couldn't always tell if it was a ball or a strike, at least from up here. This pitch is going to be bounced, a slow roller right side, and barehanding it and underhanding it over to Baxter is Batchelder for the second out of the inning.
That one came off the cap of the bat right at the end. Had a crazy spin to it, but a good job by Batchelder in realizing that he had time, let the ball die down in that thick grass, made a nice hand grab, and for the second out of the inning.
That could be a dangerous play, too, though.
Very
much so.
If you
don't concentrate on that ball and you miss it, then suddenly you're having to rush it, and it turns into an error. Jordan O'Donnell now the hitter.
And a lot of it had to do with this thick grass. You mentioned that earlier in the game. That would have actually got through the infield grass, but because this grass is so thick, it really just died.
The 1-0 pitch catches the inside corner for a strike, 1-1. Yeah, but we were walking around on that before the game, and we were kind of amazed how thick that grass was. And then compared to the dirt infield, it was pretty hard.
It's almost
contrast.
Even
after it had been watered, yeah. Up and in, 2-1. Batchelder working quickly. He gets up on the rubber, gets the sign, and gets to work. That pitch is just a little bit low, 3-1. After O'Donnell, Chris Clements, the designated hitter. That pitch is low for a ball, and O'Donnell draws a walk.
Last couple pitches, low and inside, trying to jam the hitter. But just unable to find the strike zone on that, I bet.
Chris Clements is batting for Nate Sampaolo, the second baseman for Pacific Grove. And he steps in, the number 7 hitter in the order. Short lead for O'Donnell over at first base. Batchelder, the lefty, comes to the plate and misses outside a ball, 1-0. Now here's what O'Donnell is looking for over at first if he wants to get a jump. He wants to make sure Batchelder crosses the plane with his right foot as Clements takes a strike, 1-1. And the plane being his left leg. So you can see the left leg, the push-off leg there for Batchelder out on the mound. When the right leg crosses the left, you can run as a hitter. If it doesn't cross, as a base runner, you know the pitcher has to come home. If it doesn't cross, then the pitcher can still throw to first base and not suffer a balk. So that's what O'Donnell is looking for right now. Here's the pitch to the plate. Batchelder outside corner for a strike, 1-2. Of course, this is all going to be moot in a moment if Batchelder keeps catching the corner like that.
Yeah, he was working O'Donnell inside and back with Clemens, working him outside in this at-bat.
There is a swing and a miss, but the ball is in the dirt, and a throw over to first. Marcus to Baxter retires Clements for the third out of the inning. That is the first strikeout for Batchelder in the ball game, and we are through 1.5. The score is Menlo 2 and Pacific Grove nothing. You are following the action on one of two locations, folks, CIFCentralCoast.tv. or youtube.com/playonnetwork. We're your home for high school sports in the Central Coast section.
Looking for a great place to advertise your business while reaching the greater high school community? Then you want to advertise on CIFCentralCoast.tv. We have great rates for your business while giving you the opportunity to get your message out to a very important demographic. For more information, give us a call at 619-677-3246. And once again, that's 677-3246, area code 619.
As we get set for the bottom half of the second inning, Carswell out to face the 8, 9, and 1 hitters in the Menlo order. That'll be Carson Badger, Graham Stratford, and then Freddie Avis. Badger is the third baseman batting for the right-hand side. He steps in. And he has got an open stance, folks. What does that mean? Well, it means the lead foot is left foot. Starts out as he fouls this one straight back. Starts out closer down the third baseline. Then he brings it forward in front and steps toward the pitcher. You don't see this batting stance too often anymore, Bo. Most hitters going with a closed stance where the left foot is more in front of the right. This curveball is up and in, 1-1.
Some players prefer that batting stance because it gives two eyes on the pitcher instead of just the one eye. It gives you a better look at what's coming.
This pitch is bounced up the middle. Playable on a second hop by the shortstop. Nice throw over Zaplak to Cody for the first out. And that infield, you could see that last hop took a little bit up. And we mentioned the hardness of the infield a couple times so far in the broadcast, but it came into play in the last game where Aptos and St. Ignatius, a ball hit to an Aptos defender, bounced over his head on that second hop because it hit the turf and skipped up and over his head cleanly. One ball and no strikes to the number 9 hitter, Graham Stratford. Swing and a miss, strike one.
Yeah, at the bottom of the lineup right here, Carswell just wants to attack the zone, make the hitters hit the ball.
That one's just a little bit up, 2-1. And while that sounds elementary, Bo, I mean, you do want to make those guys, you don't want to get too fine with guys in the bottom of the order. Make them put it in play.
Let your defense do the work.
Exactly, swing and a miss, strike two. 2-2 now to Stratford. He's got a battle with these two strikes, and he fouls one down the third baseline. Not a bad idea. Goes the other way, a little inside-out swing. The 2-2, low and in, and the count goes full. One out in the inning, 3-2 pitch. Ball four. And a situation where you got tried to cut a corner, catch a corner on an inside pitch, you don't get it, and then you leave it a little bit up, and now there's a runner on for Freddie Avis, who tripled to deep right center in his first at-bat.
Yeah, it's been as far as the ball hit off of Avis's bat, it's been the best hit we've seen all day today, Jeff, in that first at-bat.
Runner at first, one out. That pitch is high to Avis. Ball one.
Yeah, and Carswell knows all too well he roped his breaking ball. So we'll see how he comes at him in this second at-bat.
The 1-0 is fouled away left field side. For a moment, Burner was lined up in that right center field gap as the center fielder, Bo, and then coaching staff caught a glance and said, hey, scoot back a little bit closer to center. So he's playing Avis to pull, but not as dramatically as he was just a moment ago. This pitch is rocketed to deep right field in the corner and is going to go foul into the parking lot. Wow.
It's a leadoff hitter.
Yeah, with some power, clearly.
He is the DH, though.
O'Donnell's getting a workout out there in right field when Avis comes to the plate.
Maybe Burner had an idea.
Yeah, Burner might want to scoot. I think he took a step more towards that right center gap. Carswell's going to throw over, and Stratford's back in easily. One ball and two strikes with one out on Avis. Carswell is going to leave it way outside, 2-2. Well, I could see why. He does not, anytime he's throwing the ball inside on Avis, he's giving it a ride. I hope someone didn't park their car right up against that fence behind the right field corner there, because they may have a souvenir that you don't want. Swing and a miss, strike three. Carswell, nice job. Goes outside corner, or the outside half of the plate, and gets Avis swinging, and that brings Mikey DeKroger to the plate. DeKroger walked and scored in the first inning.
Avis went fishing after a pitch right there, high out of the zone. Nice job by Carswell and burning that one right by him for the second out of the second.
2-0 Menlo. Toss over to first base. And Stratford is back in. We'll see if Stratford is in motion. He's got a short lead, so you're thinking probably not here. This pitch is inside. Almost hits DeKroger. Ball one.
DeKroger tried to do as much as he could.
Yep.
Without leaning into that pitch too much. Turned back. Tried to let that ball bounce right off his back leg. Unable to get it done.
This pitch is down the middle of the plate. DeKroger just missed it. Fouled it straight back. One of the things I'm noticing about the Menlo uniforms, and we're seeing this maybe a little bit more and more, and perhaps it's making a comeback, is the stirrups. And showing them as well. A lot of major league players wear it, cut the pants off, so it actually goes down below the heel of your shoe, a la Barry Bonds when he was playing with the Giants. But this one's fouled away into the crowd, third base side behind the dugout. But now, at least at the high school level, from the teams we've been seeing today, a lot of the players wearing the pants up high like they did back in the 70s and 80s.
Right. Well, styles like that almost come full circle.
You know, every 20 to 30 years or so, it comes back into vogue.
It's like, it's cool, but it's not cool. But now it's cool, so we're going to do it because no one else is doing it.
This pitch is going to be bounced towards the second baseman. Playable, going the short way. Nice quick toss from Sampaolo to Zaplak at short to force Stratford, and that's how the inning will end. So a base runner is stranded on the 4-6 put out fielder's choice. That will end the second inning. The score remains 2-0. Menlo leading it over Pacific Grove in this Division III championship game here in the Central Coast section. You're following the action on CIFCentralCoast.tv, part of the PlayOn High School Sports Network, and also on YouTube.com/PlayOnNetwork.
Want to have your game broadcast live on the internet and be able to watch it again and again on demand while making money for your sports program? Want to give your students the opportunity to create their own broadcast for your school's athletic events? Then contact us at info@kbcsports.com. We offer season packages for schools, a full curriculum for your students, and an opportunity to raise up to $10,000 for your sports program. Again, that's info@kbcsports.com, or call us at that magic number, 619-677-3246. And once again, it's 619, area code 677-3246.
Kevin Russo, Micah Mader, Dean Berner for Pacific Grove in the top of the third inning to face Jake Batchelder, who is cruised through the first two innings. He has given up just one base runner, a walk. He has struck out one. No hits so far in the game for Pacific Grove.
Six out of the seven batters who have made contact through the first two innings, all kept in the infield. Only one made it to the outfield. It was that line drive by Wes Carswell, the pitcher. Other than that, everything's been topped off. He's somewhat keeping the batters off balance through the first two innings.
Russo, the third baseman for Pacific Grove steps in. Outfield is playing a little bit shallow. Batchelder's first pitch is swung on a miss, strike one, on a pitch that was probably outside.
When you're facing a pitcher like Batchelder, you want to be aggressive, but you don't want to give him strikes. He'll just take advantage of it.
By throwing a great breaking ball in the outside corner like that, that is unfair. What a great pitch. 0-2 on Russo, who's in a bit of a hole, and strikes out on three pitches.
And that's exactly why you don't want to give him a pitch. It leaves every pitch in his arsenal available, and he took advantage of it. Batchelder with his second K through two and a third.
That is Bo Fertig, hitting coach and prophet, predicting that one as Micah Mader, the left fielder, steps in from the right-hand side, one down in the third inning. And this one is thrown behind a Mader. And I don't think that's a message pitch for the number nine hitter. I think that one just got away from Batchelder.
Still, though, that still remains in the back of your head if you're a batter. Having a ball fly by you, 85 miles per hour, yeah, it's not going to be too easy.
Here's the 1-0, and that's high. 2-0. You know, hitting a pitch baseball is already one of the toughest things to do in sports, much less when you're worried about your own safety at the plate. This pitch is in and a little too far in, 3-0.
Yeah, if you look at it, if you're hitting 30% of the time and getting on base, you're an all-star. If you do that in any other sport, you're playing at the D-League or minors.
That is a strike. That's absolutely right. If you're shooting 30% from the field in a basketball game, you're not getting a lot of playing time. Or you're told, just go rebound. Here's the 3-1 pitch. That is ripped down the line, foul into left field. As it rattles around in the left field corner, that was a nice drive by Mader. But yeah, now he's in a full count situation.
A great job by Mader in jumping on that 3-1 pitch. He knew what was coming. He's that number nine batter, so he knows that not a lot of respect is given. Jumps on that 3-1 pitch, just unable to keep it within the lines.
Batchelder trying to come back from a 3-0 hole. A curveball just misses, and Mader draws the walk. Second walk of the game given up by Batchelder. And now Berner is the batter. Berner grounded out to first base unassisted after seeing seven pitches in the at-bat his first time up. Now we'll see if there's a play on for Pacific Grove. Do you think Pacific Grove has to be aggressive here in this type of a game against a team Menlo, the number two seed, versus the number nine? Well, they're going to bunt. Great bunt by Berner. It's going to stay right on the line fair.
Well, I don't know if you would consider that aggressive, but smart. Switching it up. When you have a pitcher dominating through the first couple innings, you want to switch it up. And by doing that, lay down a bunt, make the pitcher come off the mound, create something different. What a beautiful bunt. That couldn't have been executed any better.
It stuck in that thick grass on the infield and then just died right on the chalk. Not a big lip from the infield to the dirt. And that brings Zaplak to the plate. Zaplak popped out to third in his first at-bat, 0-for-1. And he looks at a strike on the inside corner.
Yeah, I'm gonna use a Jeff Kurtz quote. He couldn't have walked out there and placed it better. Any better than that. That's
so
about
true.
As good as it gets.
So true. First and second, one down here in the third inning, top of the third. And that pitch is just off the outside edge, 1-1. Zaplak to be followed by Carswell, barring a double play ball. Batchelder checks second twice, and now he's going to throw. No, he's going to fake it. You only have to commit and throw to one bag, and that's first. You can step off and look at first, but if you make a move to first, you got to throw there. Every other base, though, you can fake. What about that third fake to third first situation where they don't throw to first? As long as your first move is to third, you're okay there, too. This pitch is low.
And in the majors, they're actually talking about maybe getting rid of that play.
The third to first play?
Right, right.
Everyone always screams balk in the crowd, though it's a legal play. I'm glad we saw that here at the high school level, and we've got some savvy baseball fans here who did not scream for a balk. The 2-1. Low, 3-1. And now an outstanding opportunity for Pacific Grove. Heavy underdogs in this game. They've got their number two hitter with a 3-1 count and a runner in scoring position. Another one over at first base. One out in the top of the third. Here's the pitch to Zaplak. He lofts it high in the air infield. Infield fly rule. The batter is out, and the runners can advance at their own risk. The shortstop, DeKroger, will catch it anyway, and there are two outs.
Zaplak wishes he had that pitch back right down the heart. of the plate, just unable to drive it towards the outfield.
That's the second time he's gotten just under one.
Right.
He popped a third the last time, now to short. Carswell, the batter, he lined out to left in his first at-bat, trying to help himself here. And that pitch from Batchelder on the outside corner for a strike.
Yeah,
that backdoor breaking ball is really working for him right now.
I was just going to say that, and Carswell ripped a fastball. So Batchelder knows he has to switch it up a bit with their number three hitter.
Wisely goes to the curveball for that first pitch, the 0-1. That is poked right field line foul right against the fence. And the count is now 0-2. I'll tell you what. Burner is really moving. He was right up on Amader's back. In fact, I think he actually ended up passing him and jogging back after the ball went foul. Burner trailing Amader. Amader at second, Burner at first. But, boy, that kid can run. The 0-2 to Carswell. Bounce toward the shortstop. This is playable to Kroger charging. He's going to hustle the throw and make the play. So, a bit of a pressure situation for Batchelder, but he shrugs it off after runners were at first and second with only one out. Gets out of the inning with no damage. We move to the bottom of the third. 2-0. Menlo leading it in this Division III Central Coast Section Championship game. It's the inaugural season of CIFCentralCoast.tv. We covered basketball during the winter. Spring sports here today in the Central Coast Section. Already did boys volleyball last week. Baseball today, that will conclude our activity in the Central Coast section, but we will be at it in the Sac Joaquin section on Monday on CIFSacJoaquin.tv. More baseball coming your way on Memorial Day. 3 games from Sacramento City College beginning at 12 for all you baseball junkies out there. Join us for some more high school baseball on Monday on CIFSacJoaquin.tv.
KBCSports.com and the Play On Sports Network showcase great high school games every week. And now you can access our content using multiple platforms. Follow us on Facebook, get the latest KBC and Play On news on Twitter, or catch our highlights in high definition on YouTube. All of our content can now link to your favorite social media site. Share all the high school action you see every week, brought to you by your home for high school sports, KBCSports.com and Play On Sports.
Menlo is going to send Zeisler, Batchelder, and King to the plate. Your 3, 4, and 5 hitters for the Knights. As we move to the bottom of the third inning here from San Jose Municipal Stadium, home of the San Jose Giants, single A affiliate for the San Francisco Giants. Zeisler struck out looking in his first at-bat against Carswell and fouls off the first pitch for strike one. Boy, these batters right now are not missing by much on some of these pitches down the heart of the plate.
And this is the second time they've seen Carswell, so they know what's coming. They know the release. They have a better idea, at least, of the release point.
Curveball, right side, base hit. Nice job by Zeisler going with the pitch. He singles to right, and the leadoff man aboard for the second time in the game for Menlo.
Zeisler, in his first at-bat, struck out on that same exact pitch. This time realized it, stayed back, got his hands through, and poked it between first and second. That is about as good as it gets as far as hitting a curveball the other way.
Batchelder, another player, went the other way in his first at-bat, singled to left field. 1-for-1 in the game. Pitch to home plate, low and in. Nice dig by Bershinger. And we have yet to see a stolen base today. That goes back to our Division II game earlier. We're now into our 10th inning of baseball here at the Muni. And no stolen bases, but Zeisler with a good lead. This is driven high into the air to right center field. Settling under it is Burner in front of the warning track, and he will make the catch. And there is one out.
Batchelder just missed that one.
He hit it a long way. It's 380 to dead center, Bo, and that must have gone about 360 feet.
Yeah, got a fastball. Good part of the plate. Got his hands through nice. Hips moved right with him. Just unable to square it up.
The batter now is Will King, who has an RBI in the game. on a walk. He's going to ground this one to first, looking for a double play. Cody's going to throw it away. Conyall Cody had the right idea, but rushed the throw, and the shortstop, Zaplak, couldn't come up with the ball in the dirt. Backing up the play was the left fielder, Amader. But now there are runners at first and second on the error by the first baseman. One out in the inning, and Austin Marcus the batter. Marcus also an RBI in the game, a sacrifice fly. In fact, Menlo's got three hits in the game, Bo, but their RBIs were driven in with a walk and a sacrifice fly without an actual hit. First pitch, inside corner, strike one. We're in the bottom of the third inning, 2-0 Menlo, looking for more. Pacific Grove had this exact same situation in the top half of the third. First and second with one out, came away with nothing. The 0-1 pitch, curveball, right field corner. This is going to be extra bases, or at least one. Nope, they're going to send him to second. One runner is going to score on his way to third, and holding there is Will King. And on the double by Austin Marcus, he has his second RBI of the game, and it's 3-0 Menlo.
Using the whole field, great job by Marcus right there. And once again, staying back on that curveball. This is the second time around, so they have a better idea of the release point. Staying back. And that breaking ball had good break on it, but it stayed up in the zone. Thus, easier to hit.
And he didn't try to pull it. He went with the pitch. Now the batter is Sam Crowder, who struck out looking in his first at-bat. Takes a strike on the outside corner. Runners at second and third. One out, 3-0 Menlo. That ball died in the outfield grass. Didn't roll all the way to the corner. That would have been worse for Pacific Grove. This one's fouled away beyond the bleachers on the right side, 0-2. But still, Marcus able to leg out a double.
Yeah, that's two hits we've seen this inning on breaking balls where they're using the opposite side of the field, and that's what you're taught when you're young at this age. Go the other way. If you try to turn on a breaking ball, you're going to roll it over.
And then there's another one outside, and that is going to fall for a base hit. Another runner will score as King walks in with a run. Over to third goes Marcus. That is the third time. Boy, what good coaching. I mean, this is a well-coached Menlo team, but we've got a lot of guys who are going the opposite way on these curveballs. And you're right, you talk about rolling it over. That's a double play ball, or I know they were second and third in that situation, but it's certainly a ground ball to the left side if you try to pull it, but go with it and you get a base hit.
And that last pitch was actually a fastball. It was a great pitch down at the knees, outside, but once again, Crowder using the whole field, just sticking his bat out, keeping it long enough in the zone, and driving in their third run.
Their fourth.
Oh, they're fourth. Well, let me make that correction then.
4-0 our score.
There we go.
Carson Badger,
it's
0-1.
There now.
0-1 in the game. An 0-1 pitch fouled right side. 0-2. One out in the inning. Runners at the corners.
And it's the bottom of their lineup doing it. It's the bottom half of their lineup with all four RBIs up to this point.
The 0-2 pitch in the dirt. Runner is going to go. Throw to second base. And they're trying to induce a run in from third. They're going to run the runner all the way back to first base. Crowder dives back into the bag safely. Nice defense by Pacific Grove. That pitch was in the dirt. A ball. Nice block by Bershinger as well. Oh, actually, no. They said he swung on it. Strike three? He did. Yep. They said they called him out. They said he did go. It was a check swing, but they said he went around. So Badger is out on strikes, two down in the inning.
If that was the case, Zaplak could have just got him going back to first,
yeah,
and that would have been
the
third out of the inning.
He didn't recognize it. So, I mean, that check swing, it was looked like Badger might have held up in time. But now the hitter is Graham Stratford, who walked in his last at-bat last inning. Runners at the corners, two outs. This one is fisted towards the first baseman, Cody, who's going to shovel it over to Carswell for the out. 3-1 on the putout. Two runs in, however, for Menlo. And they now lead 4-0 after three innings of play here from San Jose Municipal Stadium. CIF, CentralCoast.tv, and youtube.com/playonnetwork. We are all part of the PlayOn High School Sports Network.
Need a highlight video for your athlete working to earn that four-year scholarship? Then you want to contact kbcsports.com. We can provide recruiting video for any athlete in any sport. Not only that, but we can give you your own recruiting page right on our website. No more mailing DVDs to colleges. Instead, email coaches the link to your personal page. It gets that easy. Not much easier than that. For more information, including pricing, contact us at recruits@kbcsports.com or call us at 619-677-3246.
Batchelder out for his fourth inning of work. He can go five today at the high school level. They track you by innings and outs, and you can only go so many innings in a week. So Batchelder available for five, and right now cruising along, likely to last through all five. Barring a Pacific Grove rally right here, the Breakers find themselves down 4-0 in the top of the fourth inning, and they have their 4, 5, and 6 hitters coming to the plate. Conyall Cody, Dan Bershinger, Jordan O'Donnell are the scheduled hitters. No runs, one hit, one error for the Breakers in the game. 4 runs, 5 hits, no errors for the Menlo School.
Batchelder now with a 4-run lead. Wants to attack these hitters. He doesn't want to give them – he doesn't want to allow the
Take your time. We got 7 innings.
Right. No, he wants to attack these hitters. He doesn't want to give them easy pitches. He doesn't want to get runners on easily is what I'm trying to say.
Conyall Cody looks at a pitch high for a ball.
Make these batters earn getting on base.
Well, and when you've got that 4-run lead, you can be more aggressive. And that's a pretty good-looking pitch from Batchelder that just missed on the outside corner, 2-0 on the number 4 hitter for Pacific Grove. Here's the pitch to Cody. Inside corner, fouls it back. Count is 2-1. Pacific Grove located right over on the coastline and usually ends up under a blanket of fog. Though we were told it has been nice weather here this spring for this baseball season. But during football, we've heard, not so much in terms of warm weather. Very candlestick-like over there as the 2-2 pitch. Curveball, what a beauty, strike three swinging. Wow. That one just fell off the table at the end of it.
Yeah, I don't know the batting average against lefties for Batchelder, but it has to be low. You saw that perfectly right there, that breaking ball going away from the hitter. Not many times are you going to get and square that ball up.
One out in the top of the fourth inning, and the batter is Bershinger, who grounded out pitcher to first in the second inning, his first at-bat, 0-1. Only 3 base runners in the game so far for Pacific Grove. 2 walks and an infield bunt single. Count now 3-0 on Bershinger as the Menlo School crowd takes exception with the home plate umpire's call on that pitch in the inside corner. Gets a strike there, does Batchelder, 3-1. That pitch, up and in, ball 4. I'll tell you what, if Batchelder was missing, he wasn't missing by much. That's the 3rd walk he has issued in the game, however, to go against 3 strikeouts. Now the batter is Jordan O'Donnell. He recorded one of those walks in the second inning. And we've got a pinch runner who's going to be coming on for Bershinger, the catcher, which you're allowed to do so the catcher can get ready for the next inning. That's going to bring out number 25, Chris Fife. So Fife is now the base runner. Running in Bershinger's place. Runner on first, 1 down. Top of the 4th. O'Donnell looks at a strike on the inside corner.
Good job by Batchelder right there in getting ahead of this batter.
This one is topped back to Batchelder. He's just going to go to first. Fife will advance to second base. 1-3 on the putout. Two down. Runner in scoring position, however, for Pacific Grove. And Chris Clements, the designated hitter, is the batter. 0-for-1 in the game. Struck out swinging in the second inning. But, boy, if there would be a time for Pacific Grove to get a big hit, it would be right here to make this a 4-to-1 game. See if they can get Fife in from second base.
That's the second comebacker, lazy comebacker we've seen thus far. That lefty tails away from the right-handed batters.
And there's a great example of that right there, Bo. The ball tailing away from Clements down and away, and Clements swings and misses for strike one.
And PG could really take a page out of Menlo's book, go the opposite way with that pitch. Trying to turn on it is not going to do much.
Batchelder fakes a throw to second base.
Batchelder does a really good job in keeping the runners close to the bag. They're not really allowed to get that secondary jump.
This one is going to be bounced toward the shortstop. Slow roller, going to be a tough play. DeKroger's not able to handle it. Fife is going to hold at third, runners at the corners. That might have been a base hit anyway for Clements. We'll see how they score that, if they scored an error or a single. As Menlo was playing Clements to hit to the opposite field, so DeKroger was jockeying Fife at second base and playing deep, and there they're going to call that an infield single. And I think that's the correct call.
Yeah, I would too. It was going to be a tough play for DeKroger right there. And that's exactly what happens when you try to turn on a ball going away from you. Off the end of the bat, dies in that infield. Maybe a quicker infield, it would have been an easier play. Because this infield is so thick, very tough play by DeKroger.
Actually worked out for Clements in that he topped the ball towards the shortstop, given how the defense was aligned. This pitch low and away to Russo, who struck out swinging last inning to lead off the third. Now has a chance to drive in a run with a base hit. Two outs in the inning. That pitch up and in, 2-0.
One of the differences in this game up to this point has been the bottom of the lineup for Menlo. Let's see if Pacific Grove can come back with an answer with their bottom of the lineup up.
A swing and a miss on a breaking ball down and in.
Not only was it a breaking ball, but it was a 2-0 breaking ball. And you have to have a lot of confidence in your catcher to throw that breaking ball with the runner on third.
Got to have a lot of confidence in your pitcher as well to call for a curveball
right
with 2-0. Russo might have been better served just to take until he got a strike. Instead, now the count 2-1.
After that swing, you could tell he was looking fastball dead red.
That one misses, 3-1. There hasn't been a pitch across the plate yet, just that one Russo swung on and missed, counting as a strike, but that might have been ball four now at least. Now a 3-1 count.
Nice adjustment, though, right there.
They're going to throw to first, and they almost got they almost got Clements leaning. Fortunately, Clements wasn't too far off the bag. He pretty much landed right on top of it when he dove.
Yeah.
Just kind of fell over on it.
Fell on that pillow.
The 3-1 to Russo. That misses. Ball four. Bases are loaded. And the batter is Micah Mader, who has walked in this game. A Mader looking, heck, a walk here would be just as good as a hit, would drive in a run. A Mader, a senior. His final game in his Pacific Grove career could make a big impact on it right here.
Look, fastball right here. Any breaking stuff, let it go.
Batchelder's first pitch misses way away. And Batchelder laboring a little bit. He's got two walks in the inning, an infield single. He's got four walks given up in the game. And his catcher, Austin Marcus, going to go out and have a quick chat. I got to think, given that of the last six pitches that Batchelder has thrown, none of them have been in the strike zone. One was swung on and missed, but boy, maybe the conversation with Coach Ruiz is, look, wait till he gives you a strike. Bases loaded, two out, top of the fourth, a 4-0 Menlo lead. That pitch, low, 2-0. I mean, that's what I'd be thinking right now as a hitter, Bo, unless you are offering a descent. I would take till I got one.
No, exactly. With bases loaded, a walk brings in the run. Walk is just as good as a hit right here in this position.
The 2-0. High, 3-0. Well, if ever there was no need for a take sign, it would be right now. Batchelder walks in the run.
He's all over the place right now, Jeff. Missing high, missing wide, a couple balls in the dirt. He's having a tough time finding that strike zone right now.
Pacific Grove has their first run of the game. Amader, two walks in the game with the RBI, and the batter is Burner. And Coach Schoaf out to the mound. Batchelder is good for 5 innings in terms of his limit. But right now, with 2 outs in the fourth, struggling to get through the end of this inning. Burner grounded out to first, as Batchelder will stay in the game, and then bunted for an infield single in his last at-bat. There will be some activity, though, in the Menlo bullpen down the left field line in the left field corner. So Burner, looking at a pitcher who's thrown 8 of his last 9 pitches, they've all been balls. And the 9th one was out of the zone. The first pitch. That is a curveball high. 1-0. That is on the outside corner for a strike. 1-1. And now you become a hitter if you're Burner.
Yep, green light from this point on right here with the count even.
Sacks full of breakers with 2 outs, and now we've got time called by Burner. Batchelder doesn't even move off the rubber. Normally a pitcher might do that and take a break, but he's going to. The 1-1. Almost hit Burner. He was thinking maybe I should have stuck a leg out on that one and gotten our second run of the game. 2 balls and a strike.
The ball's just getting away from Batchelder right now. He's not getting on top of it, allowing the ball to go away from right-handed batters into left-handed.
The 2-1. That is driven for a base hit into the gap. That's going to score 2. On his way to third base is Amader, and a 2-RBI single. For Dean Burner, has got Pacific Grove right back in this game.
A great job by Burner right there, staying on top of the pitch. It was on the outer half of the plate. A good job staying with it, driving it up the middle, bringing in 2 runs to cut the deficit.
And this will make things interesting, too, because Burner can run. So with a first and third situation, and Amader with some pretty good foot speed over at third base, Zaplak, the hitter. Zaplak has popped a third and then popped a short, though on an infield fly situation. He would have been out even if the shortstop, DeKroger, had dropped the ball. First and third, 2 down, 4-3 our score in the top of the fourth. This ball is a strike. Burner not going anywhere. Really didn't even take that big of a lead over at first base. I'm kind of surprised. At least get to the cut of the grass, but he's well short of that. This pitch is a breaking ball outside corner. Nice one. 2 strikes on Zaplak.
Well, if you were going to run a trick play with the guy in first and third, this would be it with your number 2 batter down 0-2.
Burner is going to go. There's the throw down to second base. Burner is in safely. 1 ball and 2 strikes. The stolen base for Burner. And now a 1-2 count. A base hit could drive in 2 more. Big pitch coming up here for Batchelder. The 1-2. Curveball driven into right field. That's a base hit. There's going to be a play at the plate. Here comes Burner. The throw is going to be cut off, and in safely is Burner, and Pacific Grove has a 5-run inning and their first lead of the game.
I believe that was a breaking ball, Jeff, that Zaplik stayed with, got his hands through with the ball in the inner half of the plate. His first two at-bats just got under the ball, popped it up in the infield. This time, rips the curveball to right field and gives Pacific Grove their first lead of the ball game.
The Breakers have batted around. Runner at first, two outs. There's going to be a throw over, but Zaplak is back easily. And probably the happiest Pacific Grove player is the one in the batter's box right now. Carswell went to the dugout trailing 4-0 at the start of the inning. He watched his teammates hit. Now he's up, and he's up 5-4. The pitch driven into the gap, left center field. That is a long run. It's going to roll all the way to the wall. Coming in to score is Zaplak. On his way to second and heading to third is Carswell. Here is the throw, and he is out. But the run will count. The RBI for Carswell makes it a 6-4 Pacific Grove lead. He'll be given a double to the left center field gap, and then he is retired at third for the third out of the inning. But Pacific Grove bats around, and there is new life in that Pacific Grove dugout. They lead it 6-4 through 3.5 innings here at San Jose Municipal Stadium. You are following the action on CIFCentralCoast.tv. Folks, you can catch the best of Central Coast baseball on CIFCentralCoast.tv. You can watch a replay of all of today's game after each games after each one concludes. Plus, check out our game highlights later on next week. Or order a DVD or Blu-ray disc of the game. Just click on the link below the description of this game as you're watching it in your media window. And that's how you can go ahead and place your order. We're your home for baseball in the Central Coast, CIFCentralCoast.tv.
Wow, what a great inning, Jeff, for Pacific Grove right there. Driving in 6 runs. They looked all but down and out up to that inning. Really, Batchelder was in control. Lost control of the strike zone. And Pacific Grove, at bat, doing a great job. Looking at a lot of pitches, getting on base easily, and getting the runs in when it counts.
Well, I'll tell you what. You're absolutely right when you say lost control of the strike zone. Because 3 walks issued in the inning, 4 hits as well, given up by Batchelder, but a lot of those came after the walks. Just that one infield single, that was it for the inning through those other 3 walks. And then the single driving in 2 runs Burner, another single driving in 2 runs Zaplak, and then the double by Carswell drove in Zaplak. A lot of damage being done by the bottom half of the
right
order, but in this time, other than Menlo, who's been using the bottom half to drive in the top half, it was the bottom half getting on, the top half driving
right
him in for Pacific Grove. Now it's Avis, DeKroger, and Zeisler, who are scheduled to face Carswell in the bottom of the 4th inning. And Avis, who has ripped a few balls, one that would have been a home run if it had stayed fair. In his last at-bat before striking out, he tripled in his first at-bat to right field.
And I know I didn't say it too well when I got a little tongue-tied, but that's exactly what I was talking about right there. Getting guys on base and the top of the lineup driving in runners with ducks on the pond.
This one is low and in on Avis 2-0, and Bershinger is going to go out and talk to Carswell for just a moment. Make sure they are on the same page. Or maybe it's just simply, let's throw some strikes on Avis here. But they're also trying to stay away from him.
Yeah, he has a little bit of an open stance.
This pitch, outside corner for a strike. That's exactly what Pacific Grove wants to do against Avis. 2 balls and a strike.
Yeah, some open stance you'll see come close, but he really stays open throughout the whole at-bat.
Outside and high. 3-1. Well, Menlo really wants to get the leadoff man aboard here, trailing 6-4. Good way to come back against a team that just took the lead against you is to get some runs of your own. If they shut you down, that gives them even more confidence going into the 5th inning. The 3-1 pitch is rocketed to deep right center field, way back, and this one is out of here. A home run for Freddie Avis.
Wow. The leadoff hitter has two of the deepest hits we've seen all day up to this point. And that one on the inner half, we talked about it. You got to stay away from a guy like that. Right in his powerhouse, inner half of the plate, and rips it to right center.
With the wind blowing against it. I mean, that would have been out even further if there had been no wind today. And Coach Ruiz is going to take a moment to go out and talk to everybody. And he's going to replace Carswell.
Yeah, Carswell threw a lot of pitches in the first couple innings. And now that this will be the third time around at facing the top of the lineup, not a bad idea by Pacific Grove head coach.
Well, let's see. Carswell is going to move over to third base. Coming into pitch is Conyall Cody, the junior. And then over to first goes Kevin Russo. So let's shift things around defensively a little bit. Wes Carswell is now at third. Over at first, moving from third to first, is Kevin Russo. And then going from first base over to the mound, Conyall Cody. So Carswell will finish the day with three innings pitched, three plus. He gives up five earned runs. Six hits. Doing a little math here, folks, as you can tell. Strikes out four.
Yeah, we don't have the luxury of electronic stats.
No, we do not. And issues three walks. So that is Wes Carswell's day. But boy, his double, even though he was thrown out at third base on the play, his double a moment ago in the top half of the fourth inning looming larger, because that is now the margin of the lead for Pacific Grove in a 6-5 ball game. Mikey DeKroger now set to face Cody, a left-hander. DeKroger, 0-for-1 on the day, scored a run, walked in the first, and then grounded out on a fielder's choice to end the inning in the second, and he takes a strike from Cody on the outside corner, 0-1. Cody shakes off three different signs from his catcher and then throws a pitch that DeKroger bounces foul down the first base line. Bershinger staying behind the dish for Pacific Grove. Six runs, five hits, one error for Pacific Grove. Five runs, six hits, no errors for Menlo. Nobody on, nobody out. Bottom of the fourth. That pitch just misses outside. 1-2. Cody is going to get DeKroger to lift one down the left field line into foul territory, and running out of room is a Mater. And that's one where the wind took it.
Right, exactly. You took the words right out of my mouth, Jeff. It looked like that ball was going to stay in the field of play, but that wind just taking it over out of play. Left fielder was on it, too. Had a beat, just unable to jump over the fence in the stands.
So DeKroger stays alive. Cody comes to the plate and gets him swinging. Strike three. Tell you what, Cody's got some good stuff. And there is one down in the bottom of the fourth, and the batter is Zeisler. Singled and scored in the third inning, struck out looking in the first, 1-for-2.
Yeah, majority of the time, a left-handed batter has the disadvantage against a left-handed pitcher with that breaking ball moving away. Tough to hit.
First pitch from Cody, who's not wasting any time outside, ball one. Then a pitch up. 2-0. And another pitch up, 3-0. Tell you what, Cody does not waste any time out on the mound.
No, he picks up that.
Gets a sign and he goes.
Yeah, exactly.
The 3-0. Outside corner for a strike, 3-1. Up and in, ball four, and the walk issued to Zeisler. So now the batter is Batchelder. Batchelder, 1-for-2. A single to left, a fly out to center.
Fly out to deep center in his last at-bat.
Zeisler has a good lead to the cut of the grass. Cody comes to the plate. Nice dig by Bershinger. Good block. One ball and no strikes. That one well outside, 2-0.
Cody needs to keep his front shoulder more closed in on those last two pitches, flailing wide open.
There's another pitch outside, 3-0.
Might be concentrating on the runner on first a little bit too much right now as well. Sometimes that can add complications to a left-handed pitcher.
Well, he's about to have runners on first and second here. 3-0 and gets the inside corner, 3-1. This one is fouled. Wow. Someone got a haircut over there in the Menlo dugout.
That was
a rocket.
Yeah, that was socked over down the third baseline.
Stay awake over
there.
Yeah,
if they weren't awake, they sure are now.
The shadows now going over the pitcher's mound, so Cody pitching out of the shadows, which is to his advantage. This one is going to be bounced a high chop coming across the shortstop. Only one play, first base. Zeisler is at second on the 6-3 put out of Batchelder, and there's two down in the inning. Nice play by Zaplak to Russo, and the batter is Will King. King walked in a run in the first inning, got the RBI on that, and then reached on an error in the third, came around to score. So he's been involved in two of the five Menlo runs in some capacity in this game. He's going to ground one towards the hole. Russo, the backhand. He's going to underhand toss to Cody for the third out of the inning. So Freddie Avis hits a mammoth home run to right center field to give Menlo a run. They cut into the Pacific Grove advantage, but the Breakers still lead it 6-5 through four innings in this Division III championship game. Jeff Kurtz alongside Bo Fertig. You're following the action on CIFCentralCoast.tv.
Catch the best of Central Coast Section Baseball on CIFCentralCoast.tv. You can watch a replay of today's game after each one concludes. Plus, check out our game highlights. Or you can order a DVD or Blu-ray disc of the game. We're your home for baseball in the Central Coast, CIFCentralCoast.tv.
Also catch the games on your mobile device on YouTube, youtube.com/playonnetwork. As Batchelder out for his fifth inning of work, Cody, who led off the fourth inning before the barrage began for the Pacific Grove Breakers, he will lead off here in the fifth inning. He'll be followed by Dan Bershinger and then Jordan O'Donnell. Batchelder, this is the last inning he can go. He's good for five, according to his innings limit for the week. And so after that, Coach Schoaf will be forced to dip into his reserves. So he's got a lot of good arms over there on that bench. Really, that's like asking Mark Zuckerberg to dip into his millions for something.
Yeah, I'm sure Batchelder is going to be on a short leash right here. If he walks the first batter, I don't see any reason why they won't go to one of their backup pitchers after giving up six runs in that last inning.
Conyall Cody 0-for-2 in the game. He is the one breaker who has yet to reach base. And he just hit the ball to center field, and a nice running grab by Graham Stratford. Cody retired on one pitch. Nice looking hit there, but a great play by Stratford, who is playing Cody to pull and had to go to left center field to make that play on the run.
Stratford was playing on the right side of second, but he was playing shallow enough to get to that ball. Great play by Graham.
The batter is Bershinger, 0-for-1 in the game. Walked and scored a run in that fourth inning. Grounded out to first, or excuse me, to pitcher, in his first at-bat in the second. This one is lofted to Stratford, who's going to have to hustle in and make another catch. Two down. Stratford, I think, thought that ball had a little bit more mustard on it than it did, but off the end of the bat, came in and made the play. And there are two outs quickly in the fifth.
A great job by Batchelder right here and coming back strong in this top half of the inning. Didn't let that last one affect him.
Well, he's getting it down the plate and letting his fielders make plays.
Well, yeah, there you go. That always helps the situation out as well.
O'Donnell walked in his first at-bat, then grounded to pitcher in his second, 0-for-1. That pitch is a strike, 1-1. And this one is going to hit him. So with two outs, O'Donnell reaches on the hit batsman, and Chris Clements is the hitter. Clements is 1-for-2. An infield single in the fourth inning. Kept the inning alive, actually, with two outs. Hard to believe all those runs, we didn't even mention this, Bo, came with two outs in the inning for Pacific Grove in the fourth. This pitch is a little high ball, 1. Clements also struck out in the second inning. 1-for-2 with a run scored. Runner at first, two outs. That one is low. On deck, Russo. Throw over to first, but O'Donnell was about two steps off the bag, so he's in easily. Clements is going to loft one to right field, but coming on and making the catch is Chris Zeisler, and that will end the inning. So one runner stranded for Pacific Grove in the top of the fifth inning, but nice job by Batchelder bouncing back from the six-run fourth for the Breakers to have a relatively easy top of the fifth inning. We move to the bottom of the fifth with the score. 6-5, Pacific Grove leading it over the Menlo School. You're following the action on CIFCentralCoast.tv.
Looking for a great place to advertise your business while reaching the greater high school community? Then you want to advertise on CIFCentralCoast.tv. We have great rates for your business while giving you the opportunity to get your message out to a very important demographic. For more information, give us a call at 619-677-3246. And once again, that number is 619-677-3246.
Jeff Kurtz alongside Bo Fertig. Cameraman Robert Fields here today as Bershinger airmails the ball out beyond the center fielder on the throw down to second base. Berner is going to retrieve that one and get it in. Due up for Menlo this inning, Austin Marcus, Sam Crowder, Carson Badger. Conyol Cody out for his second inning of work. Has struck out one and walked one. Hasn't given up a hit through that first inning. And he forces Marcus to foul this one off right side, 0-1.
Marcus already with two RBIs up to this point. First time at bat with no runners on base.
A double in the third, a sacrifice fly in the first, accounting for the two runs batted in. This was a nice pitch by Cody in the dirt that Marcus cannot hold up on, and he's in an 0-2 hole.
Tight snap on that breaking ball, especially from the lefty coming into the right-handed batter. Looks like a strike, drops out of the zone.
That one low and in, one ball and two strikes. This one is bounced foul right side. Count remains 1-2. We have the Division I championship game. It was scheduled to begin at 7 o'clock, but I don't think we're going to make that. But stay tuned, folks. We'll have more baseball coming your way after the Division III championship. Here is the 1-2 pitch, up and away, 2-2. That one is high, 3-2. So Cody, who started out pretty well against Marcus, making him foul one off and making him look somewhat silly on a curveball in the dirt. Now he's thrown three balls well outside the strike zone. Full count. That one is high, ball four. And so Marcus does a nice job working his way back from an 0-2 hole and gets the base on balls. And now the batter is Sam Crowder, who has driven in a run in that third inning on a single. He's also struck out looking. We'll see if there's a bunt play on here with the number 7 hitter in the order for Menlo. Marcus has a good lead over at first base. Crowder's showing bunt and bunts it foul. In the air, no less. Dropped the bat head and lofted that one up into the air. Wes Carswell is pretty much setting up shop at the front doorstep of Sam Crowder. He is about halfway down the line as soon as Crowder showed bunt. No balls and a strike. Crowder showing bunt again. They're setting up outside for him. This is off the plate. Going to snap throw over, but in safely is Marcus. And the count is 1-1. Crowder shows bunt again. Now pulls back, swings and misses, throw down to second base, and Marcus is in safely with a stolen bag.
Yeah, I was going to mention a pullback slap just because Carswell was coming down the third baseline so strong, but they got what they wanted. They got Marcus in scoring position now. Now with two strikes, you'll like to see the swinger or the batter swing away and try to get it to the right side of the field, advancing the guy from second over to third with less than two outs.
Meanwhile, Cody going for the strikeout with a count 1-2. Comes to the plate, curveball high and away, 2-2. On deck, Carson Badger. Strike three, swinging. Nice job by Bershinger grabbing that ball before it hit the dirt. There's one out in the inning. And the batter is Carson Badger, 0-2 in the game, the only member of the Knights to not reach base so far in this Division III championship. Grounded out to short in the second, struck out swinging in the third against Wes Carswell. Cody, that's his second strikeout in an inning and a third. Runner at second is Marcus. And they're going to fake a throw to second base. 6-5, Pacific Grove. We're in the bottom of the fifth. That one fisted to the right side. It's going to fall for a base hit. Marcus is going to hold up at third base. Nice job getting the ball in quickly. Charging hard, Jordan O'Donnell. A base hit for Badger. Now everyone on the Menlo Knights has reached base in the game. And there are runners at the corners with one down, and the batter is Graham Stratford, who is 0-1 with a walk. And had a couple of nice plays in center field last inning. Well, Bo, do you anticipate a play on here with Badger over at first and Marcus at third and less than two outs?
It's tough to say. A lot of it depends on the speed. I don't know the speed of the players on the bags. It's tough to say, and you have your number 9 batter up with the top of the lineup coming up next. So even if your 9 batter does get out, you still have the top of the lineup coming up with runners in scoring position.
Bershinger has moved Carswell in at third, in case Stratford were to drop down a surprise bunt. This one, Stratford's going to try to bounce it by Carswell at third base and misses foul. And the count is no balls and two strikes. Cody could really use a strikeout here. And he's got another batter with two strikes on him in this inning. But he lost Marcus and walked him and had Badger with two strikes and allowed a base hit. Crowder. I stand corrected. Crowder actually struck out. Badger did not get that deep in the count. The 0-2 pitch. Breaking ball just upstairs. 1-2.
Yeah, another reason it's tough to run a play with a guy on first and third is because there's a left-handed pitcher, and there's not much deception with the left-handed pitcher looking at first.
This pitch away, 2-2. A game of cat and mouse here a little bit between Cody and Stratford, a battle of nerves. Cody from the stretch. This one fisted, and it's going to short hop the second baseman who can't handle it, and they only get the force out at second base. We're tied. That ball hung up in the air. If Sampaolo makes the play cleanly, he might have a double play or at least holds the runner at third, but he bobbled it, and that allows a runner to score, and we are tied at six. Badger is forced out at second base, and over at first is Stratford on the fielder's choice.
Not the prettiest of plays, but effective. Gets the runner in from third, ties the ball game up 6-6, and you're happy if you're Coach Schoaf with your number nine batter bringing in that tying run.
Making contact and putting it on in play with two strikes.
Right, and that's all you could ask for sometimes with the count 2-2. Put the ball in play, make the defense react, and because of it, they got a run in.
Now the ever-dangerous Freddie Avis at the plate. Big swing and a foul tip into the glove of Bershinger. Avis, 2-for-3 on the day, a triple and a homer, an RBI, 2 runs scored. That sandwiches a strikeout in the second inning. Quick snap throw over to first base, but Stratford is back. So Cody's got to be a little bit careful against Avis. Count is 1-1. Another throw over to first, Stratford back in plenty of time. Tied up in the bottom of the fifth inning, 6-6. The pitch to Avis, and this one's going to get away from Bershinger. Heading down to second base is Stratford. Avis committed on the swing, so the count is 1-2. It's a wild pitch on the play. And now there's a runner in scoring position for Avis.
Yeah, great pitch by Cody right there and staying away from the hitting zone of Avis. Every ball we've seen him rip has been the right side of the field. Make him go the other way.
This pitch is going to be bounced foul. As you can see, Bershinger setting up outside.
And if you're Avis, let him throw that breaking ball on the outside of that plate, because look at that big gap in left center. Burner, the center fielder, shifted way over to right, leaving a wide gap in left.
Yeah, if Avis hits the ball over there, he's going to have himself another triple. The 1-2 pitch to Avis. Swung on and missed, ball in the dirt. Bershinger is going to throw down to first base and get Avis, and that will end the fifth inning. But Menlo manages to tie the game up as a fielder's choice RBI by Graham Stratford brings in Austin Marcus. The score is 6-6 as we move to the top of the sixth inning. You're following the action on the Play On High School Sports Network on YouTube.com, YouTube.com/PlayOnNetwork, and also on your home for high school sports in the Central Coast section, CIFCentralCoast.tv.
Want to have your game broadcast live on the internet and be able to watch it again and again on demand while making money for your sports program? Want to give your students the opportunity to create their own broadcast for your school's athletic events? Then contact us at info@kbcsports.com. We offer season packages for schools, a full curriculum for your students, and an opportunity to raise up to $10,000 for your sports program. Again, that's info@kbcsports.com or call us at that number, 619-677-3246. Once again, that number, 619-677-3246.
Jeff Kurtz alongside Bo Fertig at San Jose Municipal Stadium, home of the San Jose Giants, as a new pitcher out on the mound for Menlo. As Batchelder goes five innings, and that is his max. So now pitching for the Menlo school is Austin Marcus,
the catcher, or catcher through the first five innings now pitching.
Exactly. And so now stepping into catch is Chris Zeisler. So we got some substitutions going on here for Menlo. So Austin Marcus is now pitching. Catching is Chris Zeisler. And we've got a right fielder to be named for the Menlo school. We'll send Bo Fertig quickly over to the official scorers to find out who is playing right field for Menlo and get that little bit of information to you. The batter, Kevin Russo, to be followed by Mike Amader and then Dean Berner to face Marcus. And the first pitch is on the outside corner for a strike, 0-1. Now a curveball away. And the count is 1-1. Russo, 0-for-1 in the game, struck out, walked and scored in the fourth. His pitch is outside, 2-1. Marcus, who's working from the stretch with nobody on, throws one outside, and the count is now 3-1. So nice plate discipline right now by Russo, and he's got a hitter's count. And this one is outside for ball four. So the second walk of the game for Kevin Russo. He is aboard. The leadoff man on in a tie ball game. And the batter is Mike Amader, who has seen nothing but free passes to first base in this game. He's walked twice, driven in a run on one of those walks. He's scored in the fourth.
Oops. Batchelder, being one of their better hitters in the cleanup spot, moves to right field. So they just did a three-way switch.
His first pitch is going to get away from Zeisler, the catcher, and down to second base and into scoring position moves Russo on the wild pitch. And Amader has got a 1-0 count. It's a familiar place for him to be. So we're in the top of the sixth inning. See if they put a play on with Amader now or if they're going to make Marcus throw a strike first. Cheating in at third a little bit is Carson Badger. He's even with the bag. Russo on at second. Here's a fake throw over to second base. Actually, we're getting word that Batchelder is over at first base. So we're following him around the infield. But still our mystery man out and right. We clearly did not get a direct line of communication from our home plate umpire. This pitch is in the dirt, 2-0, as Amader was squaring to bunt.
Yeah, the scorebook next to us was just as confused and unsure as we were. Nonetheless, Amader up That was a smart play by the pitcher right there and faking over to second to seeing if the batter would square over. He did. And if he lays one down, it would be a great execution by the number nine batter and getting that guy over to third with less than two outs.
Two balls and no strikes. Marcus having trouble finding the plate right now. Amader squares, misses on the bunt attempt, fouled it off. And the count is 2-1.
I've never played catcher, Jeff, but I'm sure it's not easy to go from catcher crouching over through the first five innings and coming to pitch in the top of the sixth. Not the easiest thing to do, I'm sure, in baseball.
Not easy to go from right field where Zeisler has been to behind the plate in a tight ball game. Amader showed bunt, then pulled back. Batchelder charging from first. Amader takes ball three. First base is open for Austin Marcus, but Dean Berner on deck, 2-for-3 in the game. 3-1 count. We'll see if Amader squares here. He's showing bunt. Marcus delivers, and the bunt gets down, and the only play is to first base. Marcus makes the play. That could have been ball four. That was up and in. Mm-hmm. But Amader works the sacrifice bunt, the runner over to third base. And there is one down in the inning, and all Berner needs to do is get a fly ball to the outfield, and Pacific Grove will be back in front.
I could take another stab at the right fielder. It might be Glenn Baxter.
So Baxter, who's been at first base, has moved to right field. Mystery solved. Meanwhile, the hitter, Dean Berner. With the infield in, Berner takes away ball one. So, to confirm, Austin Marcus on the mound, Zeisler behind the plate. Jake Batchelder's moved over to first base, and Baxter is moved from first to right field. The 1-0, Berner, a weak swing and a pitch in the outside corner, 1-1. He was trying to punch it through the infield and missed. The outfield is shading Berner slightly to right. He has an infield single and a single to center. Two RBIs, a run scored, a stolen base. A busy afternoon for Mr. Berner. This pitch, curveball fouled into the first base dugout. One ball, two strikes would be huge here for Marcus if he can get a strikeout of Berner. Kyle Zaplak on deck.
A strikeout or keep the ball in the infield. That would be perfect for Marcus right now. He wants to keep the ball low in the zone. He can't get it up because it'll be that much easier to pop it in the outfield.
Big one ball, two strike pitch here for Austin Marcus. That is ripped into right for a base hit, and Berner has put his team back in front. What a great piece of two strike hitting by Dean Berner. His third RBI of the game. And his team leads it 7-6 in the top of the sixth. I'll tell you what, for the number 9 seed, Pacific Grove right now is giving the number 2 seed Menlo Knights all they can handle.
They're playing like they have nothing to lose, Jeff. It's everything on the field right now. They're leaving everything on the field and making it count with runners in scoring position.
Zaplak has a couple of RBIs. Berner going to run on the first pitch, and he is going to be in safely with his second stolen base of the game. Zaplak, 1-for-3, a run scored, 2 runs batted in his last at-bat, and a base hit here might score Berner as well. An insurance run would be big for Pacific Grove because Menlo has shown the ability to come back. They have scored in every inning but the second. Carswell in the on-deck circle. Marcus is going to fake a throw to second base. Berner back in easily. The outfield is shading Zaplak to pull, so is the infield, even more dramatically, as the second baseman Crowder deep in the hole between second and first. Left-handed hitting Zaplak awaits the 0-1 delivery, curveball outside, 1-1. One out in the inning. Big gap in left center field for Zaplak. Berner with a lead. To Kroger, trying to move him back to the bag. This pitch, a little bit outside. No, we got a balk call.
Yep, didn't set.
It's It's our second balk in as many games. Over to third base goes Burner. Even better situation for the Breakers. Infield's going to move in for Menlo once again, and now Zeisler's going to jog out to the mound to talk to Austin Marcus and keep his head in the game. One ball, one strike, one out, runner at third base for Pacific Grove.
That walk to Russo has burned Marcus up to this point. Came around and scored off of a single from Burner. Now Burner with the speed around the base pass ends up at third off the steal and then the balk.
Marcus from the stretch. Low and away, 2-1.
If you're Zaplack, you're looking for a pitch up in the zone to get into the outfield grass.
Now we've got a timeout on the field, and it looks like a ball ended up on the field. I'm not sure where that came from.
Nice vision by the third base umpire.
No kidding.
Saw that from across the field.
Wow. Well, you can't say Ricardo Rodriguez doesn't have a good eye. The 2-1, right up the middle, line drive, deep ball is going to be caught, but that's going to bring in a run on the sacrifice fly. Burner scores. 3 RBI in the game for Zaplack. 2 outs in the inning, 8-6 Pacific Grove in the top of the 6th. Big insurance run right there for the Breakers. And a nice play in center field, by the way, by Graham Stratford. That gets over his head. That was close to getting over his head.
Yeah, those are those in-between ones where it's a line drive. You want to make a break coming up on the ball. By that time you realize it's over your head, good adjustment in center field and grabbing that one for an out.
Carswell looks at a curveball in the inside corner for a strike. Carswell has an RBI in the game, a double. Was thrown out trying to stretch it to a triple in the 4th inning. 1-for-3. Also the starting pitcher, though no longer the pitcher of record in this game. The 0-1 as Carswell waves at a breaking pitch that fooled him, 0-2.
Top two hitters for Pacific Grove, 6 RBIs on the day. So that top of the lineup for Pacific Grove doing damage.
And 7 if you add in Carswell as well. This one skied high in the air, short right field. Baxter is going to make a play on it, and that will end the inning. But not before 2 runs are in for Pacific Grove. They lead it 8-6 as we move to the bottom of the 6th inning here in this Division III championship game. Will Menlo have enough to come back yet again in this ball game? They are the defending champion with a lot of experience. Pacific Grove, it's been a while since they've been in this game. But right now, the number 9 seed leading the number 2 seed right here on CIFCentralCoast.tv.
We've got baseball for you all Memorial Day weekend. After all the action today in the Central Coast, we head to Sacramento for the Sac Joaquin Section Baseball Championships on Monday, May 28th. Game coverage starts at noon on CIFSacJoaquin.tv. Put the game on and follow the hardball action all weekend. Brought to you by PlayOn Sports and the PlayOn High School Sports Network.
Well, Bo, we've got ourselves a competitive game right now. It's
turned out to be a great game, Jeff.
It has. Our first game of the day, Division II, Aptos had a 3-1 lead against St. Ignatius. St. Ignatius came back and won it 5-3, getting 4 runs in the 6th inning to take the lead and then hold on. Here, Menlo was on cruise control, leading 4-0 going into the 4th, then gave up 6 runs to trail. They came back to tie it after getting one in the 4th, and then 1 in the 5th. But Pacific Grove has added 2 in the 6th to reclaim the lead. And now Menlo is sending Mikey DeKroger, Chris Zeisler, and Jake Batchelder to the plate. They're 2, 3, and 4 hitters. Conyal Cody out there for another inning. He's already completed 2, and he starts out DeKroger with the ball and adds another one to it, 2-0. Again, you don't want to get the leadoff guy on right after you've taken the lead back with 2 runs of your own, the 2-0 pitch. That's at the knees for a strike, 2-1.
That's exactly what Marcus did for Menlo, and that guy ended up coming around to score for Pacific Grove.
That pitch outside corner, 2-2. 8 runs, 6 hits, 1 error for Pacific Grove. 6 runs, 7 hits, no errors for Menlo. Swing and a miss on a curveball. And for the second consecutive at-bat, DeKroger strikes out. Now 0-for-3 in the game with a walk and a run scored. Zeisler, the batter, 1-for-2. Struck out in the first, singled in to right in the third, scored a run, and he walked in the fourth.
Cody got DeKroger on the same exact pitch, that high breaking ball away.
That pitch is up 1-0. Be huge for Pacific Grove if they can shut down Menlo and force the Knights to have to get 2 in the bottom of the 7th inning to tie it, 3 to win. There's a strike at the knees on Zeisler. On top of that, Bo, if Cody can get through this inning, he'll have gotten through the meat of the order for Menlo. That pitch is in the dirt, 2-1. Long way to go before we get there in the bottom of the 6th inning, but a good start for Cody in this inning, getting DeKroger on a strikeout. 3 strikeouts in the game in 2 1/3 innings for Cody. And now Bershinger is out to the mound to talk to his pitcher for just a minute. And now Coach Ruiz is going out to talk to his catcher. While the umpire goes to talk to the pitcher, I've never seen it. Usually the manager's going out to talk to his pitcher, not his catcher. I don't know if maybe Bershinger on that last one caught a ball in a spot that didn't feel so hot on that ball in the dirt. Took some time to talk to his pitcher, and now they're just giving
the umpire giving him a moment to go to the pitcher.
Yeah, to recover.
We've seen that before, a foul ball off the shin or, you know, off the shoulder or the hand of a catcher. And
Some other sensitive areas.
Right, and the umpire, and vice versa. That's how the catcher-umpire behind-the-plate relationship works, to give that person additional time to shake it off, to go out and talk to the pitcher.
2 balls and a strike, 1 out in the bottom of the 6th. Ball foul, 2-2. Tell you what, Conyol Cody has come in and settled things down for Pacific Grove in this game. Wes Carswell did a good job, but gave up 5 runs. Cody has given up just 1 through 2 1/3. Now the count is full on Zeisler, with Badshelter waiting in the wings. This pitch is actually going to hit Zeisler, and so he's on. Suppose he would have favored a less painful way to reach first base with a 3-2 count. How about you just miss in instead of on me? But either way, he is on, and Batchelder the hitter. 1-for-3 in the game. A single to left, a fly out to center, a grounder to short.
Batchelder has been one of their hottest hitters in this tournament, and now with a runner on, can tie the game up with a deep ball in the gaps.
And we have seen one already in this game. Freddie Avis, a solo homer in the fourth. There's a strike. The outfield shading Batchelder to pull, as is the infield. Wind continues to blow right to left. That has been constant throughout the day. The 0-1 pitch, swing and a miss, strike two. Will King on deck. Oh, just off the plate.
Nice recognition there. He wanted to, but he didn't let it go. Stayed back and kept the bat on his shoulders. Nice recognition on that curveball.
I'll tell you what, though. That is a very good 0-2 pitch. The 1-2 pitch a little bit further off the plate. 2-2. Curveball. Oh, that was a beauty, but it is a ball.
That one barely missed.
Wow. Could slide a piece of paper between where that ball missed and the strike zone. The full count pitch. Bounce towards the shortstop. Could be a double play ball. To second for one. Nice job. Taking out the second baseman, Zeisler, on a hard slide. The force out. And Coach Ruiz wants to talk this one over, saying that's interference. The late slide. And now the umpires are going to talk it over.
I don't see how that could be interference. It almost looked like the runner beat the play.
I think they're going to – well, let's see. Coach Ruiz likes what the call is, but right now Menlo's still got a runner over at first base and Batchelder.
Wish we had instant replay to double-check that.
Sampaolo is shaking it off. Unless they're – well, Zeisler is out, clearly on the play.
Right.
But now are they throwing him out? That is the question. A very heated conversation with Schoaf.
Wow, they got it.
They are calling the double play.
I don't see how.
Coach Schoaf and the umpire, Coach Rodriguez, are having a few words. If so, it should be three outs.
If he's out at first, that's three.
That's three outs. There was a strikeout onto Kroger. If that is a double play ball, that's three outs, and that ends the inning.
Yep.
So the rule is at the high school level, you can't try to break up a double play. You can slide into the bag, but it is also the timing of your slide. And the umpire is saying that Zeisler slid late and went for the legs as opposed to just trying to slide into the bag safely. And so it's an interference on Zeisler, and the double play is considered recorded.
That two bag is real dirty. He did not slide on the side of it. He looked like he slid right through the bag.
But you've got to slide earlier as if you're going to the bag, and they're saying he started his slide late. I'm thinking here we're theorizing from up here.
Right.
So took out Sampaolo because he was going for right on top of the bag as opposed to just trying to get into it and get there ahead of the throw.
I guess I could understand that, but at the same time, especially at this level, the sliding technique is not really refined at this level. You have players, I mean, that's why at the Little League level they have bags that pop out. It's not really, you don't really get that quality slide until you get into the minors or the majors. And wow, that was a
well,
interesting
that's
play.
I think you are making a more measured argument
than
Schoaf was trying to make.
Very much so.
With our umpiring crew.
Tough call to make, though, in that position.
Yeah,
but
that is a judgment call on the part
of the umpires.
You know
what? The second base umpire was right on top of that, so he had as good as a look as anybody else.
Well, now we move to the top of the seventh inning as Menlo comes up empty in the bottom half of the sixth. Conyall Cody, Dan Bershinger, and Jordan O'Donnell.
4-5-6.
And for Conyall Cody, he's been pitching well on the mound. But he is the only player on both teams in the starting nine in the lineups to have yet to reach base in this game. 0-for-3, a line out to center field in his last at-bat, and a great play by Graham Stratford. Cody has also struck out and grounded to second, now facing Austin Marcus. Bershinger and O'Donnell to follow. The first pitch, high and away, ball one.
His last at-bat, he got a nice piece of it, squared up on it nicely, line drive to center field. But Stratford made a nice running play on it.
Marcus Lowe, 2-0. I'll tell you what, given Menlo's offensive capability, it would behoove Pacific Grove to add a run here at least and make it a three-run game. Now, the one thing that double play ended up doing is it's forcing Freddie Avis even further away from an opportunity to get a base hit in this ball game and make an impact. You're a ways away from him. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 in the order, and then back to the top spot. Navis has done the most damage in this game. The 2-0 to Cody. That's, though, when Menlo hits in the bottom of the seventh. That one is going to be lined right to the third baseman. One of those days for Conyall Cody. He's hit two right on the money. This time Carson Badger makes the play on the line out to third, and there is one out. Dan Bershinger now the batter. Bershinger 0 for 2 with a walk and a run scored. Though it was his teammate who was pinch running for him, Chris Fife, who ended up bringing that run around. Bershinger takes well outside, ball one.
Nice job by Carson Badger on that last play. Good concentration, that ball fighting through the shadows to get to him, almost snuck up on him. But nice concentration in bringing that one in.
These shadows really favoring the pitchers right now. This one is popped foul behind home plate. Because the pitcher is starting out in the shadows. The ball is going through the sun, then through another shadow, then getting to the plate.
Yeah, what it is, it's hard to pick up the rotation. And when you're unable to pick up the rotation, it's tough to recognize pitches and jump on a pitch that looks like a breaking ball or fastball.
That one is in the dirt.
And we've seen a couple swings in the latter part of this game that we didn't see at the beginning of the game, and that might have to do with the shadows playing.
Two balls and a strike, one out, top of the seventh. Low, 3-1. Of the 8 runs Pacific Grove has scored, 7 of them have come with 2 outs. That pitch is low, ball 4. Now the batter, Jordan O'Donnell, 0 for 1 in the game. He has reached on a walk, and he's been hit by a pitch. Pitch is high and away. One and oh. Bershinger stays in the game over at first base to run. That pitch catches the outside corner, 1-1. Marcus comes set, got Bershinger back to the bag, and then a swing and a miss on a pitch well outside by O'Donnell. So something broke down on that communication. Here's the 1-2 up and in, 2-2. I don't know if there was a play on there, Bo, and people got their signals crossed, or it's just a situation where everybody got fooled, the hitter and the runner at first.
Yeah, it's tough to say because it is the bottom of the lineup. You usually don't run a hit and run at the bottom of the lineup, but you never know.
The 2-2 pitch, curveball in the dirt. Nice job by Zeisler behind the plate to block that one. The count is full.
That was the identical pitch that he swung and whiffed on to get the 2 strikes. Now full count. You're looking for a fastball right here. Doesn't want to give him base on balls.
The pitch from Marcus. Breaking ball outside corner. What a pretty pitch. Strike 3 call.
What confidence in that breaking ball from Marcus facing the bottom half of this lineup and breaks one on the outer half. Great pitch for the second out of this inning.
Chris Clements is the batter. 1 for 3 with an infield single. He scored a run. That base hit sandwiched between a strikeout and a fly out to right. First pitch low, 1-0. Kevin Russo awaits on deck. That one is high and away, 2-0. 8-6 our score, Pacific Grove leading. We're in the top of the seventh inning. two down, and the Breakers looking to add another run if they can. They've got a runner at first. That pitch grabs the outside corner, 2-1. That pitch is high, 3-1.
Clements, the DH, is in this game because of his bat. Let's see if he could put it to work with a runner on first, trying to find the gaps to bring him around with two outs.
That one is fouled off at home plate, and the count is full. So the runner at first, Bershinger, will be moving. On the 3-2 pitch with two down.
And it almost looks like as this day creaks on, that wind keeps on blowing even tougher now as those flags are blowing from right to left.
The pitch on 3-2, curveball low, ball four.
Back-to-back full count breaking balls. This time, unable to find the zone.
That's some confidence in your curveball right there, but that time it just missed. So the batter is Kevin Russo. Russo has walked twice in this game and scored every time he has walked. He also struck out swinging in the third. Two down, two on. 8-6, Pacific Grove, top seventh. Amader waits on deck, and now Russo is going to call time. Marcus's first pitch inside for a ball. Marcus better make sure he comes set again because he had a balk last inning and he almost bounced into that delivery right there from the stretch, Bo. 1-0 to Russo. That one almost hit him in the head. 2-0. Boy, he just got his mug out of the way there.
2-0 fastball, a hitter's count right now. Looking fastball, looking to rip one and find the outfield grass to bring that runner around from second.
Marcus's pitch is low, 3-0. Amader on deck, the number 9 hitter in the order. Waiting for an opportunity to add to this Pacific Grove lead if Russo gets on. And Russo's probably going to look at least one pitch here. He's going to show bunt, and that is well inside. Third walk of the game for Russo. And Amader, who's also walked twice in this game, has driven in a run on one of those walks and scored. He also has a sacrifice bunt. Doesn't even have an official at-bat in the game yet, but the bases are loaded for him.
The last two batters in this lineup for Pacific Grove, after that last at-bat, a total of 5 walks. Not what you want to be doing.
9 walks in the game for Pacific Grove and one batter who was hit by a pitch to go with 6 hits.
Tough to win ball games like that, Jeff.
Amader up there, 0-0. So 3 plate appearances, 2 walks and a sacrifice bunt. He's got 3 ducks on the pond with 2 outs. And his first pitch is low and in, ball one. And right now, Marcus looks like he's aiming this baseball, and Coach Schoaf is going to have a conversation with him. Because that first pitch, he didn't even really follow through all that much.
Yeah, and you could just tell the ball's just getting away from him right now. A lot of movement to his pitches, but he's just not coming over the top, front shoulder flailing out. And because of it, Coach Schultz, fastball, just give it to him right down the plate. The number 9 hitter, make him hit the ball. Make your defense do work for you.
Well, now Amader, who's seen his teammate Kevin Russo walk, his other teammate Chris Clements walk, Dan Bershinger walked earlier in the inning, has already looked at ball one, and hit by a pitch and will drive in another run. The kid doesn't even have an official at-bat today, and he's got two RBI.
You don't see that very often.
And a big run right there for Pacific Grove. They now lead it 9-6. The bases are still loaded, and Dean Berner, who's been absolutely on fire, 3-for-4 with 3 runs batted in, 2 runs scored, and 2 stolen bases, is now up to hit.
Yeah, this guy's been a stud today. Let's see if he can come through and open this game wide open.
The first pitch, way outside for a ball. Well, I'll tell you, when we were at 4-0 going into the top of the fourth inning, with the way Batchelder had been pitching and Menlo had been hitting the baseball, I would not have anticipated we'd be at this stage right now. The 1-0 pitch, outside corner for a strike, 1-1.
Yeah, it's the second time today, Jeff, where we've seen a team get a comfortable lead and kind of relax a bit, and the other team, I mean, just as good to be in this position in this game, coming back with a vengeance.
The 1-1 to Berner, outside 2-1. Well, when you give up 9 walks in a game and 2 hit batters, along with 6 hits, you are not putting yourself in a very good position to win a ball game. 2 balls and a strike on Berner, 2 outs, bases full of Pacific Grove Breakers. The pitch to Berner, outside 3-1. Nobody warming up for Menlo right now in their bullpen. Pacific Grove with a walk here could go up by 4. The pitch from Marcus. At the knees for a strike, and the count is full. So with 3-2 and 2 outs, the runners are going to be in motion.
2 full count at bats in this inning, and he threw a breaking ball in both at bats. With the leadoff hitter up, we'll see what he comes with right here.
Here go. No, there's a fake throw to second base. You just want to make sure Marcus makes his move to home plate before you get going. You could tell I would have already been in motion. I was calling the guys moving already. Marcus wants a reset of the signs from Zeisler. The payoff pitch. Curveball, slap foul, and we'll do it again. Nice bit of hitting by Berner just to keep himself alive. But once again, another breaking ball on 3-2. Can you believe it? I mean, usually a pitcher will go to a fastball.
At least once out of 3 at-bats, all 3 at-bats, breaking balls, and it's almost like pitching backwards in a sense.
Marcus is going to step off the rubber and look over to first. But Amader is not being held on by Batchelder. Marcus comes set. And now a fake throw to first. That's a balk, folks.
Yep.
You got to make
sure
a move
is.
Over there. You can't fake a throw to first base. We talked about that earlier. Now Coach Schoaf wants to have a conversation.
And if you were looking at Marcus's reactions after he did that, he bent over and realized what had happened.
That's the correct call, though. You've got to at least lob toss it over there or do something. And now on the balk, everyone's going to move up 90 feet, so a base is open. But it's now 10-6.
Yeah, and Marcus, there shouldn't have been any reason for him to throw over to first. He should have known the first baseman was playing off. And because of it, Schoaf definitely expressing his opinion.
But that's the correct call. I mean, you can step off the rubber and look, but if you turn and make a move that way, you've got to lob the ball over there minimally. Now with a count 3-2 at two outs, a base hit would be even more devastating for Menlo. The runners don't have to move, though. It's not a forcible situation. This pitch is a curveball, and Berner's going to swing and miss. Here's the throw to first base, and that will retire him. But two runs are in, and there wasn't a hit in the inning. Three walks, a hit batter, and a balk.
Wow.
And that will do it for the seventh inning, but two more runs in for Pacific Grove. They are three outs away from a title. You're following the action on CIFCentralCoast.tv, your home for high school sports in the Central Coast section. You're also following the action on youtube.com/playonnetwork.
Catch the best of Central Coast section baseball on CIFCentralCoast.tv. You can watch a replay of today's game after each one concludes. Please check out our game highlights or order a DVD or Blu-ray disc of the game. We're home for baseball in Central Coast, CIFCentralCoast.tv.
Folks, stay tuned for the CIFCentralCoast.tv postgame show, where we will select our player of the game and then wrap up the action from this one, get you ready for our Division I game that was originally scheduled to begin at 7 o'clock, but since we're 5 minutes away from that, that is not going to happen. Probably will start closer to the 8 o'clock hour. Meanwhile here, Pacific Grove leading 10-6, and Menlo will be sending up Will King, Austin Marcus, and Sam Crowder. And I can tell you that for Pacific Grove, if they can get these three outs here, they have not won a title in Division III. The last one coming in 1999. When some of these seniors were a mere 5 years old, and that's if they're 18. And there are a couple sophomores on this team that were barely out of diapers the last time that happened at this high school. But first, Pacific Grove needs to get through these last three hitters, and we've got a new pitcher on the mound for Pacific Grove. That is Chris Clements in the game, replacing Conyall Cody, who had a good run there out on the mound. Clements gets a strike after a first-pitch ball on King. Cody moves back over to first base. This one, line towards the gap in center field. Long run and a diving grab by Dean Berner.
What a game that guy's having, Jeff. Love the name, first of all. We mentioned that as soon as we heard it. And it's been his speed as well as his bat that has made a huge impact on today's game. That one was heading towards the gap. Looked like it was going to fall easily. Berner was on the right side of the field, came all the way across, had a great beat on it. What a great diving play.
Clements paints the outside corner on Austin Marcus for strike one. Marcus, two RBIs in the game, a double, a stolen base, a walk, a run scored. A curveball, swing and a miss, strike two. I'll tell you what, that line drive by Will King had every business being a double. And Berner stole it from him. Breaking ball, fouled at the plate. Count remains 0-2. For the Menlo School, they have won the last two back-to-back champs in 2010 and 2011. They have won five in school history. Again, for Pacific Grove, they went back-to-back in 98 and 99. But not in the 21st century have they won a title. It has been a long stretch, and Coach Gil Ruiz has been bringing this ball club back and this program, and he is on the cusp with one out here in the bottom of the seventh inning of his first title with Pacific Grove High School. Here is the pitch. Swung on and missed, strike three. There are two down in the inning.
You know what, Jeff? We've heard multiple times today from different people that Pacific Grove has no right to be in this game. They should not be in this game. They don't have that one great athlete, that one D1 guy that's going to, you know, do it game in and game out. They just do things and they don't make mistakes. They're not walking people, and that's the big thing on defense, and they're making the hits count.
Clemens gets strike one. This pitch lined towards the second baseman off the end of the bat, backhanded, throw to first, and Pacific Grove has won it. Good thing they didn't listen to their critics, Bo, because they have done what many thought they could not do. The number 9 seed has knocked off the back-to-back defending champion 10-6.
Jeff, they deserve this win just as much as anybody else. They did everything right, ran the bases well, made good defensive plays, and hit with runners in scoring position. And that one big inning with 2 outs, 6 runs scored, you're going to win a lot of ball games like that.
And they took advantage of the gifts given by the Menlo School with those 9 walks and 2 hit batters. Pacific Grove makes it count. Congratulations to the Breakers. Stay tuned for the CIF Central Coast.tv postgame show. We will be back in just a few moments. With that, we will name our player of the game as well. Again, your final, Pacific Grove 10, Menlo 6. Back with more after this.
Fourth and 10 from the 41-yard line for St. Augustine. Kennedy dropping back to pass. Looking left, firing, incomplete, intended for Nolan. No penalty flags on the field. Mar Vista will take over on downs. And Jordan Lertique will take that knee. And the Mar Vista Mariners knock off the number 2 seeded St. Augustine Saints at Mesa College in a dominating performance on both sides of the football for Mar Vista. They trailed 14-0 and came back.
Again, down 2-0, facing adversity. And they've really just turned the table around since game number 3. Set an attack, great block made back inside the Maverick zone. A chance there by Bosback back inside the Maverick zone. Ball attacked there by Bosback. A second opportunity by Bosback. Lift violation call. Winner. Oh. It's an over the net call. Oh my goodness. Bosback.
Back here on CIFCentralCoast.tv, Jeff Kurtz alongside Bo Fertig, the final score in this ball game, Pacific Grove 10 and Menlo 6. And a bit of a shocker here at San Jose Municipal Stadium, home of the San Jose Giants. A lot of people said, wow, Pacific Grove, they were a power some time ago and working their way back up. It is the number 9 seed, a bit of a surprise that they were even here in the first place. Then they're going up against the 2-time defending champions. Menlo had been really doing an outstanding job with their baseball program in the last few years, and it looked like when Menlo jumped out 4-0 through the first 3 innings and Batchelder was in control that this might get away from Pacific Grove. But as they have all done throughout the tournament, they did not listen to the naysayers, the people who didn't think they could do it. They just kept fighting and fighting, and they take advantage of 9 walks and 2 hit batters to win this ball game 10-6. Bo, what a performance by Pacific Grove.
What a feisty group of kids. Looked all but down and out in this game, down 4-0. And all of a sudden roared back with 6 runs with 2 outs, a great 2-out rally for them. And the great play of Dean Berner, obviously our player of the game today, no doubt in our minds. 3 RBIs, 2 runs scored, and that magnificent diving catch in center field. And it could have really been a totally different bottom of the 7th if he doesn't make that catch. What a great individual accolade by Berner. And when you're talking about Cody, you know, you mentioned he was the only player to not reach base, but he was also the only player to grab the win today. So I'm sure Cody will take that along with anything else. And if you're Menlo, you have to keep your heads held up high. It obviously wasn't your day today with 9 walks. You're not going to win too many games like that. And hats off to Coach Schoaf and his team.
And hats off to Coach Gil Ruiz, his staff, and the players for the Pacific Grove Breakers. Again, Dean Berner, our player of the game here on CIFCentralCoast.tv. 3 for 5 in the game, 3 runs batted in, 2 stolen bases, 2 runs scored. The diving catch you mentioned, Bo, in center field to keep Menlo from getting some momentum back in the bottom of the 7th inning. What a performance by the center fielder, but a team performance as well, as a lot of the guys in the bottom half of the order who don't usually anticipate are going to make a huge contribution in the game, they just kept getting on base. I mean, you look at guys like Micah Mader, who did not have an official at-bat, drove in 2 runs, once on a walk, once getting hit by a pitch, had another walk in the game, a sacrifice bunt. I mean, that kind of production, if you had told Coach Ruiz at the beginning of the game, Micah Mader is not going to have an official at-bat, but he's going to get 2 IRBIs for you, and he'll be on base 3 of the 4 times he has a plate appearance, you'd take that every day of the week.
Right, quality at-bats, even the sack bunt, getting the guy over and running in scoring position, and Berner drives him in the next at-bat. And a great job by the 3 pitchers. You know, it really is a collective win when you're talking about baseball and when you're talking about bringing in 3 different pitchers, an awesome win for this Pacific Grove team. They have to feel really good about this outcome.
Well, folks, that's going to do it for the Division III championship game. Pacific Grove going to be celebrating this one for a while. We're going to get ready for Division I, which will begin approximately 8 p.m., we will have that game for you here on CIFCentralCoast.tv as our coverage of the baseball championships in the Central Coast section continues. For my broadcast partner, Bo Fertig, and our cameraman, Robert Fields, we'll see you in about an hour, folks. You're on your home for high school sports in the Central Coast section, CIFCentralCoast.tv. I'm Jeff Kurtz saying so long from the Division III game, and congratulations to Pacific Grove again, 10-6 winners over the Menlo School.